Hello, my name is Danny Nolan and I'm the Director of Chassis Sim Technologies. In this video tutorial, we're going to be talking to you about how to create a monster file and why it's so important. The monster file basically is that link between your data analysis package and what you can do with Chassis Sim, because once you've got a good monster file, you can basically reverse engineer things like your tires by basically using your import monster file tab, reverse engineer what your aero is up to, and reverse engineer what your road surface profile actually looks like. So as you can appreciate, getting the monster file right is a really, really critical step in the chassis sim modeling process. So without further ado, why don't we have a look at what a monster file actually looks like. A monster file is an ASCII space or tab delimited file that basically consists of all the data that we're going to need to reverse engineer all the vehicle parameters. Now, the first column of our monster file is lap distance in meters. Basically, and as you can see here, we've got this to about 3 decimal places. Now, this is very important because what this allows us to do is really get that fine resolution we need when the car starts to go slowly. Now, I should also add that your typical monster file is exported from your data at 50 Hz. The whys and wherefores of that we'll explain in another video tutorial. Your second column is RPM. The next column after that is lateral acceleration in terms of G. Then your next column is longitudinal acceleration in terms of G. Now, if you don't have a longitudinal G sensor, or your G sensor is rather noisy, basically what you can do is set up a channel in your data analysis package that basically derives speed. Now, we're going to be actually giving you an example of that when we create a monster file, but the critical thing is when we do that is to filter it, but we'll talk about that when we look at the data. The next four columns are basically our damper displacements. So basically we've got front left damper, front right damper, rear left damper, and right rear damper. Now, I want to make the point here that basically positive values in the monster file is basically when the damper is compressing. Sometimes you see dampers basically calibrated in a way that basically compression is actually registered as being negative. If that is a situation with your data logger, basically when you come to export or create the monster file, flip it around the other way. I should also state that basically all of this is in millimeters. Now, for those of you who have monoshocks, basically what we do is that you simply take the monoshock reading here, you copy it, and you paste it right next door. Now obviously this particular example isn't the monoshock, but that's exactly what you do. Your next column is basically steering at the tire as opposed to the steering wheel. You know you're dealing with steering at the tire when basically the magnitudes of this are in the order of about plus or minus 15 degrees. Rack travel typically winds up in the order of about plus or minus 30. Steering at the actual wheel is plus or minus 100 degrees. So you're looking around about plus or minus 15 degrees, because a lot of the chassis sim toolboxes is going to use that to basically determine how the tires are actually situated. The next channel is throttle. The next channel is speed in kilometers per hour. And if you've got some load cells, basically you've got front left load, front right load, rear left load, and right rear load in terms of kilograms force. Now, I also want to state from the outset that even though a car's true zero point is in the air just as the tires are about to hit the ground, in reality for your monster file, I would recommend that you zero on the ground. And we're going to walk through that procedure. And the only reason I say zero on the ground is it's been our experience that just basically cuts out a lot of inconsistencies and a lot of errors. So, basically, this is basically what our monster file looks like. Now, if you don't have loads, all you've got to do Your monster file is going to look like this. So as you can see, if you don't have loads, this is what your monster file should look like. What your monster file should look like. If you do have loads, this is basically what it looks. This is basically what it looks like. So without further ado, let's talk about setting up our data. So what I do is I've loaded in a data set here, and typically what I do is I'll grab the outlap, and what I do is I'll basically select a section. I'll select a bit of a section of the data, and I'll just have a look, and I'll have a see what it looks like. What I'm trying to see here is that basically that it's appropriately zeroed. Now, as we can see here, the front dampers are pretty. Dampers are pretty much on the deck. The rear dampers are pretty close, but if I wanted to refine, that, all I would do is go basically zero at cursor, and I would do the same thing here, zero at cursor as well. So basically, what that does is it gives us a true. Zero reading, and exactly the same thing would apply if I had, if I had loads. What I then do is I then basically select my fastest lap, and then as you can see here, what I've basically what I've got is that basically I've already set up a template with the order that I want the channels in for the monster file. Now, as you can see, just on that point of zeroing, you know that we've pretty much got a good zero point where basically down the main straight, the dampers are just about equal. That's when you know you've chosen an appropriate zero point. So, with this particular car, you'll notice here that basically the longitudinal G sensor was basically doubled up with a lateral G sensor. So I've basically blocked that out here, and I've added my inferred longitudinal acceleration. You'll note here that I've got a filter, I've got an average filter there of about 13 samples. This basically tidies up, this actually tidies up the longitudinal G sensor, because sometimes integrating a speed signal can be a little, differentiating a speed signal can be a little bit noisy. So, what we now do is now that we've got this all set up, all that we've got to do is we've got to click on here, and we've basically got to say export data. And as you can see, I've already set this up. We want to export to a CSV file. We want to output at 50 hertz, and we include the distance, and we include the distance data. It's a little bit different for other data loggers, but we're going to talk about that very shortly. So I go to export, and I select basically I want to name my monster file that. I click on save, click on yes, and that's been exported. So what I now need to do is just do a little bit of tidying up. So I open this up in Excel, and as we can see here, I just double check that I've got all my appropriate channels. So I've got distance, RPM, G-force lap, longitudinal G, front left damper, front right damper, rear left damper, right rear damper, steered angle, throttle position, wheel speed. Now, all I need to do now is basically just get rid of the header, hit delete, bingo, that's my monster file. And all I now need to do is I'll go to file, save as, and I will choose that as a text tab delimited file. This is very key, ladies and gentlemen. Do not save as Unicode text, save as text tab delimited file, and I will call this my Star Mazda Sebring monster file. I click on save, click on yes, and I just click away on that, and I'm done. That is how easy, ladies and gentlemen, it is to construct. That is how easy it is, ladies and gentlemen, to construct a monster file. That's all there is. That's all there is to it. Just a few other pointers, as we discussed before, pointing out whether you've got something steered at the wheel or steered at the tire. As you can see, this is steered at the tire, because as you can see, my magnitudes are in the order of plus or minus 10 degrees. So that's very, very key. Now, obviously, I showed you how to do that using Motec i2. Now, obviously, there are some slight differences with Pi Toolbox, Magneto Morelli Wintax 4, Bosch's Windara. And you'll see where I posted this video on our blog. I've also put a PDF article that basically outlines some of those differences. But let me just outline something very specific that you might need to include, particularly if you're dealing with, say, Windarab, or if you're dealing with Windarab or Magneto Morelli. If you're dealing with Windarab Morelli, and this even goes for the toolbox, I'd recommend that you create a lap distance channel that's basically the integral of speed divided by 3.6. That's presuming speed is in kilometers per hour. This will ensure that you basically export out meters to a number of different decimal places, because some data analysis packages have an idiosyncrasy. They won't allow you, they'll only export distances to the nearest meter, which, as we discussed before, is something that we don't like. But I would very much refer you on to that PDF on the Chassis Sim blog, because basically what it does is it just walks you through all the different idiosyncrasies that we have found. Ladies and gentlemen, to wrap this up, once you've got your monster file, this is the bedrock of everything that you will do with Chassis Sim, because you're going to use this to not just drive the toolboxes, you'll use it to basically import to create our curvature files. You'll use it to generate circuit altitude and camber if you don't have GPS data, as well as driving all the different Chassis Sim toolboxes. Because I guarantee you, if you get this right, everything else with Chassis Sim will follow on from that.